faith you are. It's so good to be here, and I look forward. I know why you like coming to church. It's so fun, isn't it? I just love being here. I love worshiping God together, and it's just really an important gathering. It's an important time of the week, so thank you for being here. There's more to it, and I'm going to talk about that this morning a little bit. Last week, we talked about how we need to serve. You know, I was thinking about how this is really our vision statement, and it's the book of Acts. It's, I will love people, I will tell them the truth, I will serve God, and I will bear witness to him changing the world. That's the book of Acts, really, loving people and telling the truth. There's a lot of truth telling. We're going to go to that this morning. And serving, last week we saw the diaconate, the deacons were established because there were women in the fellowship. There was now diversity coming into the body, and they needed to take care of meeting the needs. And they said, yeah, here's how we're going to do it. And they organized to meet the needs. They established a bunch of people who would take that on as their responsibility. They were gifted to do that. They served from their whole heart. And in the process, God is going to the whole world. But what we find when we get to chapter 6 is they're all gathered in Jerusalem, and Jesus had said, I want you to go into all the world and make disciples. So they were missing something still. But God was at work in these mighty ways. It was really a wonderful thing. I want to teach you something that my mom taught me. You may be familiar with this already, but get your hands free a minute. Okay, you ready? Okay, put your fingers together like this. All right? And you go like this. And you put these fingers up. And you see what you have there is a little church. Did you know that? So here's the church. Here's the steeple. Open the church. And here's the people. Okay, very good. So you already know this one. All right, but did you know that there are several variations to this, which I'm going to teach you two variations today. So here's the church, here's the steeple, open the church, and what? Only 8 people came to church today. Okay, we like people that come to church. Okay, here's the one I want you to remember, though. I made this up. Here's the church, here's the steeple, open the church and let out the people. Open the church and let out the people. Okay. Yeah, thank you. I made that up. Okay, but it has a point to it, is that we are called to go. So two of the people that were christened as deacons were Stephen, over here, Mr. Stephen Carlson, named after this very man, right? And Philip, right here, Mr. Philip Paul Schmunk, named after this very disciple. My mom named me Philip Paul because she wanted me to be an evangelist. So, bless her soul. She is a godly woman. She's with Jesus right now. And she's whispering in his ear every day, do you see my son down there? He needs your help. So Jesus is saying, chill, Elizabeth. It's okay. I got this. So she's a wonderful woman. So we're going to talk about these men. Now, they were not only servants with their whole hearts, but it turns out that they were amazing witnesses of the gospel. And Stephen especially, he, we're going to see here, and we read already, he's filled with the Holy Spirit, and he tells the truth. So spoiler alert, Stephen got stoned for his telling of the truth. It cost him his very life. But, so amazing. Now I'm going to do something I probably shouldn't do. I'm going to use a football analogy. And I have sitting in the back Danny McManus. He's in the Canadian Hall of Fame for football, which so I'm really on scary ground here. But when I was a kid, we played football in the orchard next door. And, you know, it was just neighborhood football. But so somebody would be the quarterback. Usually it was my brother because he was the tallest and the biggest. And we'd all get in the huddle, okay? And then he'd say, okay, Phil, I want you to block Randy and Tony. I want you to go out, and I want you to do a dog leg left. So we're gonna go over to this side. So block him that way, and he'd give all the instructions. After he gave the instructions, though, what would he do? He'd say, "Okay, ready, break," right? And then we'd go out and do it. Imagine playing football and all the players getting in a huddle and them enjoying it so much. This is going to be great. Yeah. Oh, okay, I'm really excited about you throwing it to me. And they just kept talking about what they were going to do. And so much so that they never broke the huddle. Right? They just stayed in the huddle. After a while, they sit down and, you know, the guys are bringing them in water and they're in the huddle, you know. And the game never goes on because they never break the huddle. Well, this is Stephen. I don't know if he knew football. Probably not. But here's what Stephen is saying. Get out of the holy huddle. Get out of the holy huddle. So this is what we do in churches across the nation. And some of it's good. I mean, we need to huddle. We need to worship like this. Oh, my goodness. That's what I'm saying. I get why we come to church. It's so amazing, and I'm inspired. And there's so many times when I think I shouldn't say anything. I'm going to ruin it. We should just keep singing because it's so moving. It's so awesome. And I get why we get together. But across the nation, there are churches where people come, they huddle, and they never break the huddle. They go home still with that mindset. Wasn't that great? And they never go out and play the game. And here's what I want you to understand this morning. That's just kind of the big picture. You got to break the huddle and go out and play the game. You got to get outside. You got to open the doors and let the church loose. Because there is a world of people outside these walls. People that you and I know, we love them. They're amazing people. And even more importantly, they're worth the precious blood of Jesus. They are valued in his eyes. And we need to share the good news of Jesus. We need to play the game, right? We need to get out there and say, hey, there's more. There's better. There's a relationship with Christ that you can have. We need to find effective ways to do that. And it's challenging to know what are the good ways. I have a student in my class whose name is Ashley. And I'm teaching an ethics class right now. We were talking about contraceptives and abortion. And she raised her hand and said, "What do you think about in vitro fertilization?" So I said, "That's a great question, Ashley. What do you think?" She says, "I'm really glad you asked me that because I am a test tube baby. And I wouldn't be here if it wasn't something that was possible." And so we talked about, well, how does that affect your identity and da da da. Anyway, she's this amazing gal. And she's going to Cuba on a mission trip. She's only been a believer in Christ like 5 months. And she is on fire for Jesus. And so I'm helping her go. I'm supporting her financially. I mean, that's not about me, but I'm just so amazed by people who get it. I'm getting out of the huddle and I'm going. And that ought to be on our hearts, all of us. Serve God. So who do you know that doesn't know Jesus? Who's that person in your neighborhood? Who's that person you work next to? That relative, that person that cuts your hair, that person that mows your lawn. How can you find a way to say something meaningful for Jesus? Look for opportunities. They're there, I'm telling you. So today we have Stephen. So Stephen is this amazing guy that he's passionate. And they accuse him of saying that the temple will be destroyed and talking against Moses. But here's what he's really saying. And I don't know if you knew football, but here's what he was saying. Get out of the holy huddle. We're all gathered here in Jerusalem. There's more. And so they raise this accusation against him that he is speaking against the temple. Now, that was serious. I've been to Israel a bunch of times, and I love being there. If you ever ask me, where in the world would you like to go? I want Israel. I want to go to Israel. I want to hang out in Jerusalem. There's history all at your feet. There's so much wonderful things going on in Jerusalem. I want to be there. I want to go up on the Temple Mount. I want to be at the Wailing Wall. I want to go to the Garden of Gethsemane. And you know, this is what was going on in first century Christianity. This is the place to be, Jerusalem, just up on that hill. That's where my Savior died. And they thought they needed to be there, but they needed to get out. So this is the acrostic for our sermon this morning. S, stand. Stand. So S, spiritual situation. Stephen spoke by the power of the Spirit. I'll give you the whole cross, then I'll come back. T, twisted truth. They accused him of something that wasn't true. N, anointed answer. He talks about, by the power of the Spirit, how God has been at work throughout history outside of the temple. And it's time for us to get outside the temple. N, a non-expected result. So I told you, Stephen gets stoned. But what's so interesting about this is he's preaching, let's go. And by his death, now the church begins to get persecuted. And because the church is persecuted, guess what happens? They disperse. And so God uses what looks like tragedy to spread the gospel to the whole world. And by the way, this is the first time we see Saul of Tarsus. Paul is holding the coats of the men who are hurling the stones to stone Stephen, probably so they could throw the stones harder. Here, let me hold your coat. Then you can really smack them. I mean, that's a horrible... I can imagine that every night in Paul's dreams was the face of Stephen. Stephen, what are you doing to me, man? Don't you see the Spirit? And so they said about Stephen, his face shone like that of an angel. So my first question is, well, did they ever see an angel? What do they know if an angel looks like, you know? But here's what I think they saw. Stephen's face shone with the glory of God. And so it was the Shekinah glory of God's presence in Stephen that they saw. Just like Moses, when he was writing the law in the tent of meeting, as he would write the law, he was so full of the presence of God, the Shekinah glory of God, that his face shone, literally radiated the glory of God so much so that people couldn't stand to look at it. Moses, come on now. So he had to put a cloth over his face so that people could stand to be with Moses. Is that cool? I mean, I wish all of us needed to wear handkerchiefs over our faces. It would be a better world, wouldn't it? In so many ways. So that's what Stephen was doing. He was showing the glory of God. He gets he dies preaching the gospel. We're going to just briefly go over that. And then the church is dispersed. It's this non-expected result. And the D is for dependent significance. So spiritual situation, twisted truth, anointed answer, non-expected result, dependent significance. Stephen says at the very end, I see Christ standing. We never, when we talk about Christ in heaven, have him standing. He's always seated at the right hand of God, isn't he? So he's seated. So this is kind of unusual. I see Christ standing. I think he was standing in honor of the sacrifice of Stephen. He was, stand up, applaud, I see Christ standing. So this is the significance of Christ. So John Stott says this. You may know who John Stott was. He was the chaplain to the Queen of England, a great theologian. And here's what he wrote. God's church means people, not buildings. God's word means scripture, not traditions. We must not allow our buildings or our traditions to imprison the living God or to impede his mission in the world. Let me read that again because that's so exactly on. God's church means people, not buildings. You know, the church is not the building. Church is people of God everywhere. Anyone who claims the forgiving grace of Jesus. I've traveled the world. I've been fortunate to do that. And all over the world, I have met with the church. I have met Christians in India, Africa, Korea, Canada, there are Canadian Christians. Did you know that? Kathy's Canadian. Everywhere. They're everywhere. Places you wouldn't expect them, eh? So, I'm sorry. I don't know where that came from. There are Christians everywhere. And listen, take heart. This pronouncement that the church will forcefully advance and even the gates of hell will not be able to stop it. It's happening. It's happening. I met a bunch of Christians in China. I met Christians in Cuba. I preached in a church in Cuba about 3 years ago. It was a Baptist church. There was a balcony, and it was packed inside. They had all the windows open, and they had chairs outside the church. And there were people sitting outside the church. I mean, there were so many. And I thought, there are no Christians in Cuba. You know, they're all over the place. And they're passionate. And listen, if you live in another country, there's no such thing as a nominal Christian in other countries. You know, here in America, we have a lot of posers. They go to church, but you know, your life's really not any change. In most countries, to say I'm a Christian is dangerous. I was at a group of Baptists in India, and they had guards because the radical Hindus would come to baptisms and kill people. I mean, that's Christianity on steroids. And that's happening around the world, and the church is strong. Take heart, the church is strong. So, anyway, my wife prayed for me that I wouldn't go off on any rabbit trails this morning, but I think I just did. Was that a rabbit trail? So anyway, Stephen. So Stephen, he is accused of speaking against the temple. So now he goes on a history lesson, and I just want to tell you a little bit about what he says. So he tells the truth, and truth is not something you vote on. Truth is not up for grabs. Truth is true regardless of the situation. And I'll just tell you one more story here. So I went fishing not too long ago, and we didn't know for sure where to go. And there was a place where there were like 10 boats all anchored. We thought there got to be fish there, right? So we stopped and fished, and about a half an hour later, we found out truth is not a democratic reality, right? It doesn't matter how many people think there were fish there. There were no fish there. No fish were biting. It just wasn't true that day. So we went somewhere where there was nobody except the dolphins, and we caught a boatload of fish. So here's the bottom line. The dolphins know where the fish are. But anyway, truth is presented by Stephen. So now he goes through a history lesson, and I want you to pay attention to the places that he talks about. So if you go through Acts chapter 6, he talks about at the end, well, in chapter 7, he starts in with Abraham. He talks about Abraham. While he was still in Mesopotamia, before he lived in Haran, God said, leave your country and your people and go in the land I will show you. He met with God, and he wasn't in the temple. Okay, that's an important point. So he goes on, he tells the history story. Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, he talks about Egypt and Cana, and how the great acts of God in Egypt, and they weren't in the temple, hello, and they met with God, and the world was changed. So then he talks about Moses, and he talks about Moses being in the wilderness for 40 years, and finally meeting with God at the burning bush. And the Lord said, take off your sandals, the place where you are standing is holy ground. And you know I'm going to make a joke about coffee right here. That God said, there was a coffee plant, there were holy grounds. God was drinking coffee while he was waiting for Moses to come. But anyway, well, there is a book called Hebrews. But anyways, I know, you've heard it all before, but that's a good, that's good. That's a bowl of deliciousness right there. So, God meets with Moses. It's not in the temple. And God meets with the people of Israel in Egypt, in the wilderness, in the promised land. It's not in the temple. And significant things happen outside the walls. And really, a big message that Stephen is getting here is God does not live. So God does not live in temples made by hands. And so he actually says that near the end of chapter 7, he says how Moses, they set up tents for God, and God met with them. Our forefathers had the tabernacle of the testimony with them in the desert. It had been as God directed Moses according to the pattern he had seen. Having received the tabernacle, our fathers unto Joshua brought it with them, and they took the land from the nations God drove out before them, and it remained in the land until the time of David, who enjoyed God's favor and asked that he might build a dwelling place for God, and it was Solomon who finally built the house for him. However, the Most High does not live in houses made by men. Doesn't live here. We meet with him here. It's wonderful. But God is at work throughout the world. And if God is at work outside these walls, isn't that where we should be? And so now he goes from preaching to meddling. This is actually the ministry of a pastor. So do you know this, right? Pastor's job is to comfort the afflicted and to afflict the comfortable, right? And so we get oh so comfortable coming and sitting in padded chairs. We got air conditioning most of the time. And, you know, the lights are on. We give you cookies. It's wonderful. Well, who wouldn't want to come here? But you can't stay here. This is where we get inspired. This is where, think of this as a sending station. Think of this as a launching pad. This is a place that you go out from, empowered by the Holy Spirit, full of his love and mercy, and you tell people, everybody you know, everywhere you go, you tell them about Jesus. Sometimes they'll stone you for that. That's what happened to Stephen. Jesus said, in this world you will have trouble, but take courage, I have overcome the world. Here's what you need to know. I am a child of Christ. I am a representative for him. I am a citizen of heaven. And when you understand who you are, it has a lot to do with what you do. And so I know you get that. And I love that you do this. You tell your family about Jesus as opportunity comes. You tell your neighbors. You tell your coworkers. You tell the guy, the gal that cuts your hair, that mows your lawn, that fixes your car. You tell them, hey, except for the grace of Jesus, I'm in trouble. But he loves me, and he loves you too. And you tell people everywhere you go. And so this is the amazing wonder of what God calls us to do. So that's it, really. You were done early. Here's the church. Here's the steeple. Open the church. Let out the people. Let's be the witnesses of God in a world that's hurting, in a world that is uncomfortable right now, that's not at ease, that is, there's all this angst and fear and struggle. Listen, Jesus is the hope of the world. He's got it. It's going to be okay. And we can shed the peace of God wherever we go. Let's be those people. Can we pray together? Lord, thank you that you have the answer. Thank you that you are the light of the world. Thank you that you are the bread of life. Thank you, Lord, that you are the living water. You are the one, Lord, that gives us hope in a future. You are the one that gives meaning to life. And so, Lord, when we ask ourselves, how does this all work? What does this all mean? It all comes back to you love us, and you've got a plan for us, and it's a good plan. And all we got to do is just surrender to you and follow your path, and you will take us amazing places. You will do amazing things. And, Lord, we thank you for that. Thank you that truth is always true, regardless of popular opinion. Thank you that we can rely on your word and your promises. Thank you, Lord, that you give us hope in the future. So, Lord, let us be fully the people of God that you intend for us to be. This is your hope. I will be your God and you will be my people. Lord, we want to know how, and we need the power of the Holy Spirit to live out being your people. So reside in us, live through us, speak through us, be glorified in our lives. Lord, we can't do that on our own. We know that. But we are depending on you to show yourself mighty and powerful. And we thank you for that in the mighty, glorious name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let's please rise.
Things I just want to say to you. Number one, we live in an interesting time. We've got hurricanes, earthquakes, tornadoes. We live under the threat of nuclear war. I want to say to you, don't mess around. Come to Jesus. I'm serious. This is the time. Don't wait. Come to Jesus. If you don't know him, you need to know him because he is our hope and our future. So especially now, Come to Jesus. And now here's the second thing. We've been in a holy huddle. And here's what I say. Ready? Break. Let's go. Okay. God bless you.